What a blessing and a joy to have another Sunday morning being here in the presence of you all and the presence of our Lord. A couple of announcements or prayer requests, actually. First of all, is there a new timer? Anybody first time here, very first time? Okay, well, glad you oldies are here. Yeah. That does sound bad when we get to be our age, my age. But I see some of our winter visitors are returning, so welcome back. And at this point, we don't have a specific person coming for next week, but we're working on it. So plan to be here unless designated different. We're working on that. And we have a prayer request from Lanny and Betty. She's still in the hospital, not progressing as fast as they would like. And so it'll be a while. They may not be back over here before the first of the year. Pastor Chuck, same thing. His rehab is going a bit slower than he would like. But progressing, you know, still progress is being made. And then Sam and Cindy's daughter, Lynette, we need serious prayers for her. She has COVID. She is on a ventilator, and the hospital has been in there for 2 weeks. And Sam said it's not looking good, so we really need to uplift her in prayer. Are there any other prayer requests specifically?
Yes, I'd like to ask for prayers for my son, Michael.
Michael?
He is has leukemia. He's going to have a bone marrow transplant real soon.
All right. Michael with a bone marrow transplant, Lynette with COVID, anyone else? Betty, of course. All right, let's just go to the Lord in prayer before we open service. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come to the foot of your throne, present our requests, and thank you for all that you do for us. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, we ask for a healing in Betty, Lynette, and Michael. Through the physicians, that they would do the right things, that the procedures would be handled correctly and properly, that you would guide their hands to do what is right. For each of those people, we pray that we know that some know the Lord, don't know the specifics on all. But we pray, Lord, that you would touch them with your Holy Spirit. Let them know your presence, that they may come to know you even more. We ask your blessing on this service, a special anointing on Dave. May we be open to what you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing, I've Got Peace Like a River. Of this body of believers, We ask for your vision for us.
Yes.
Send the person that will perform the needs to this community.
Yes.
Father, we ask that you would touch the hearts of those that are even thinking about it or don't haven't even thought about it. We ask for your direction and your guidance for this body of believers and trust that you will bring the right people here.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, we all say,
amen.
Amen, which means, so be it. You may be seated. Without this body of believers here, we won't be able to bring the needs, you know, to prayer, because we won't know if we don't have a place to come and talk to each other. So keep that on your prayer list all week long. And it's not very much so.
All right.
our lives to know you. We trust your name.
Thank you.
walking in despair, play that song all day long. Get in the presence of God. He'll take care of those troubles. Ushers, prepare for the offering. Tom, you want to take that side and stand in the middle, maybe? Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for the privilege to come before you. We ask right now in Jesus' name that the gifts that are given would be multiplied and the giver would be blessed beyond measure today. We pray for this community. We pray for this church. That these funds would help supply the needs. Once again, Father, send the person that needs to be fulfilled ministry for our body, that we can continue to go out and bring people to Christ. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. I'm going to be leaving again, so I'm putting the worship into the perfect hands of Sam. I'll be gone for an undetermined amount of time. And so Sam will be continuing on as your worship leader. I'll miss you all. I'll see you when I see you. Oh, the glory of his presence.
Thank you, Ruth Ann. Appreciate your leadership this morning. It's great. And for all of you here, my name is Dave Edwards. If we haven't met yet, I'm here with my wife, Jan. And it's been our pleasure to be here the past few weeks with you, getting to know some of you better. I hope that you've enjoyed getting to know us better. I don't know. But we have certainly enjoyed getting to know you better. It's been a delight to be here and to worship with you. I want to especially thank Bill and Mona here, sitting in the front, because they've hosted us. You know, they've put up with us for a few nights now. So thank you very much for doing that. It's a generous thing that they can do in the name of the Lord. So I appreciate that very, very much. Jerry, you widening that camera just a little bit, because I tend to wander.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, thank you. I can't stay still when I preach. It's just impossible. We're so happy to be here. So glad to be here with you. And we are praying for Oasis Community Church. I know Jan and I are, and our district is as well. And we're anxious to see what God will be doing here in the next few weeks and months. So thank you. We have been looking at core values. That has been our theme for the past few weeks. Recall, we started off with core values. We said that core values are really how we live our lives. Core values determine how we live. The things that we think are important to us, the things that matter to us, the values we hold dear, that really determines your course of action in your life. It determines what you think is important, how you live your life, and what you do, and your purposes and goals. And so we've been sharing these seven core values that we believe every single believer should have and hold dear to. This is the sheet. If you have not gotten one, there are some in the back, but you can pick up the sheet. We are looking at this. You notice there are seven on here. Because I'm only here 4 weeks, we're not going through three of them. I apologize for that, but you can still go through those and study the scripture verses, if you would, and look at those. But the core values, the very first one we looked at was number one, lost people matter to God. He wants them found. And lost people should matter to us. In our community here of Casa Grande, lost people matter to God. He wants them found. Number two we looked at, that is, prayer is the primary work of God's people. It's not just an afterthought, not something we do if we don't have anything else to do or nothing else works. It's the first thing we do. It's the primary work of God's people. And last week, we jumped to number four, and that is God's Word. Knowing and obeying God's Word is fundamental to all true success in life. Not success as the world defines, but success as God defines. And so we looked at God's Word last week. This week, we are going to number five. And number five talks about the Great Commission. And it simply says this. Completing the Great Commission will require the mobilization of every fully devoted disciple. Can you say that with me? Say it with me, please. Completing the Great Commission will require the mobilization of every fully devoted disciple. What is the Great Commission? Who has an answer? Just shout it out. What's the Great Commission?
Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations.
Okay, there you go. Go into all the world, preach the gospel to all nations. And that's actually a good one from chapter 16 of Mark. Where is the Great Commission found? The one we normally go to. What chapter, what book of the Bible, anything? Where's the Great Commission found?
Matthew 28.
Matthew 28. Usually it's verses 18 through 20, though we focus on verse 19 primarily. So having said that, allow me to read for you Matthew 28, and you can turn to it in your Bibles as well, because we're going to be looking at this. I'll be taking apart various phrases and words from those three verses, and you can follow along with me. But here we go. Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. This is Jesus speaking. He said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." That is what we call the Great Commission. Now, when did Jesus speak those words? Anybody? Yes, before he ascended back to heaven. So he's gathered with his disciples on the mountaintop, ready to go back to the Father, having completed his mission here on earth. He's ready to go back to the Father, and he's telling his disciples who remain, "I'm giving you the mission now. I'm commissioning you to carry out the mission that I came to do." What was the mission that Jesus came to do? Well, we find that in Luke chapter 19. Luke 19 is a great story. You've probably heard this story already. But in Luke chapter 19, there's a story about a short guy. Remember his name, Zacchaeus? And he heard that Jesus was coming to town. And so he decided, because he was short, he'd climb up in a tree, get a good view of Jesus as he passed by. But Jesus, as he passed by, stopped and looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, you come down. I'm going to your house today." Of course, all the people in the crowd, especially the religious leaders, were aghast. They were stunned. Why would Jesus go to the house of this tax collector? He's a cheat, a fraud. He steals money. He's the greatest of all sinners. Why associate with him? And you see by verse 10 that salvation had come to Zacchaeus that day. He became a disciple of Jesus. Or verse 9. And in verse 10 it tells us this. Jesus said, "For the Son of Man," speaking about himself, "came to seek and to save the lost." He was telling the crowd the whole reason why he came to earth was for people like Zacchaeus, who were sinners, because he came to seek and save the lost. And now the Great Commission he's giving disciples is telling them, you complete that mission to seek and save the lost. You're to go out to all the nations with the good news of Jesus. That's the goal. So that is the Great Commission. Now today what I'd like to do is quickly go through 10 facts about the Great Commission. Now, I hesitate to use the word facts because sometimes we think they're just things to memorize or learn. But really, these are things that are important for you to know and understand, but also to live out in your life. So here we go. Let's go through 10 facts about the Great Commission. The very first one is this. It's never called the Great Commission in the Bible. There's no place in Scripture where it uses that term, the Great Commission. Now, we're not sure exactly who started it. Scholars have traced it back to some 17th century Dutch missionary. But it was actually Hudson Taylor who popularized the term. Remember Hudson Taylor? He was a 19th century British missionary who served 51 years in China. And he would often talk about this Great Commission. So we really see it from the 19th century. Is it a commission? Absolutely. Jesus is commissioning his followers to go and make disciples. Is it great? I think so. I think it's one of the greatest things we can do. I mean, that's the importance of what God has placed upon us, his followers. As he goes back to heaven, Jesus says, you go and make disciples. But it's a relatively new term for the past couple hundred years. But it's a great term to describe those last words of Jesus Christ. Number two. Go to fact number two. The Great Commission is given to a group, not an individual. You notice that it is given to all the disciples that are gathered there, not just to Peter, the ringleader. Now, if you look at the Greek, when it says the word you, we understand that it's actually plural. In verse 20, Jesus says, I am with you always. That word you in Greek is plural, not singular. So it says, I am with all of you. Or if you're from the South, I'm with y'all. Okay? So I'm with y'all, all of you. And that is not just Peter, not just John, but all of you. And that's the same thing he tells us today. I am with you all, always, to the very end of the age. He has promised never to leave or forsake. All right? Now, the Great Commission is meant to be carried out in community, together. Okay? It's not a solo mission. It's not the mission for the pastor. It's not the mission for a missionary who goes overseas someplace. It is in community, together, we carry out the Great Commission. So all of us, you all, are involved in completing the Great Commission. Third fact is, it's a call to make disciples, not just to go. Now, here's the thing. When I learned this verse growing up, the emphasis was always on the go. That's the way it is in English. Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples. I always had the idea, okay, I have to go to Africa, China, someplace I'm not sure if I really want to go to. And so you kind of say, okay, it's not for me. I don't feel called to go. But Jesus wasn't speaking English here. And actually, it's written in Greek. And if you look at the way the Greek sentence is laid out, you'll see the direction is not go. In Greek, the main action in Jesus' commands is the Greek word methetuo. Methetuo. That is translated make disciples. That's the primary command, the directive. So you see, the word go is not the main directive. That's not the main thing. So let me share with you an example of how that would work in real life today. Let's say you have a neighbor that knows that you're going to go to the store to get some groceries. And so what the neighbor does is comes over and says, you know, as you go to the store, when you get to the store, would you please get me some eggs? When you go to the store, please get me some eggs. Now, what is the directive there? It's to get the eggs. And as you go to the store, get the eggs. That's the most important thing. That is the instruction, is to get eggs. So when we apply that to the Great Commission, you see Jesus is really saying, as you go, make disciples. The emphasis is on making the disciples. And we can say simply this, or Jesus would say, as you're going about your daily business, as you go wherever I lead you to go, make disciples. And for you today, it's the same. Jesus is saying that to you. As you go about your life, make disciples. You don't have to go to another country. I mean, you can stay right here in Casa Grande or wherever you might travel throughout the United States. But as you're going throughout your daily work, your daily business, your daily life, in your neighborhood, at the store, wherever it is, make disciples. That is the directive that Jesus gives. Okay? Now, number four. Disciples aren't just followers. Now be careful, because I'm trying to make a very fine point here. We talk about disciples of Jesus being his fully devoted followers. But you see, Jesus was moving from town to town during his ministry on earth. And as he did, there were great crowds that followed him, huge crowds. They heard about, you know, the things he taught. They were intrigued by what he said. They heard he performed miracles. They wanted to see a miracle. I mean, wouldn't you follow somebody if they said they performed miracles? And they heard that he took a small boy's lunch and fed 5,000 people with it. Maybe he could give us some food. That'd be great. So there are a lot of people following Jesus around from town to town, but most of them were not fully devoted disciples. Now, this Greek word that we talked about, methetuo, which means make disciples, speaks about more than simply a teacher-student relationship. It's more than just simply a student sitting in a classroom and learning all the knowledge that the teacher is throwing at them. It has in mind, in those days, that a student would actually become a disciple of the teacher, and they would follow the teacher around, and they would learn everything the teacher is pouring out to them, like the disciples did from Jesus. But they would also imitate the language, the conduct, and the habits, and the pattern of that teacher. So they became true, like clones of the teacher. And that's the thought of making disciples here, is that when we make disciples, we're actually making people or followers of Jesus
who become like him, not only in the knowledge of him, but also in his conduct. We become more like Christ. So making disciples is encouraging people to become followers of Jesus in both conduct as well as in doctrine. Now, let me go on to number five. As I mentioned earlier, Mark also recorded the Great Commission, these last words of Jesus before he ascended. Mark 16:15 is a great passage too. And in Mark 15:16, Mark records Jesus as saying, "Go into all the world and preach the good news of the gospel to all creation." Now that's really what Matthew 28 is saying, isn't it? It doesn't use the word disciples there, but preaching or proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ, making disciples, and it has that worldwide view of all the nations. So we're not just content to have the gospel here at Oasis Community Church, but we want to see God's word go out to all the world, to all people, those who have never heard. There is number six. Excuse me. Number six says, the Great Commission flows from the authority of Jesus himself. When you look at it, you see that this isn't a simple suggestion that Jesus is making. He's not dropping a subtle hint. He's not saying, well, you know, if you got some extra time, maybe you could make disciples. Or I know you're busy now, raising a family, and kids, and working all, but when you retire, then you'll have time to make disciples. No, Jesus isn't saying that. This is a direct command, okay? And as a direct command, it has the whole force of heaven behind it. Look at verse 18. When Matthew says in 28:18, all authority, Jesus says, in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All authority in the universe, that's greater than the Supreme Court in the U.S. or the president or any ruler on earth. All authority in the universe has been given to me. Therefore, I am telling you to go and make disciples. It carries the whole weight, the creator, the heavens and earth behind him. So when the God of the universe says you should go and do something, you should probably better go and do it. Okay. It carries the authority of Christ. It's not just something that a pastor thought would be a nice idea. Number seven, all three members of the Trinity are involved. Again, it's that verse 19, beautiful verse, that talks about to go and make disciples of all peoples, all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Did you know this is the very first place in Scripture where all three members of the Trinity are mentioned at the same time? It's important to understand here, when you look at that verse, it says baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now that word name, again in the Greek, is singular. It's not plural. It's singular. So there is only one name. And that's our definition of the Trinity. There is only one God. But he's evident in these three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all three take part in our salvation. All three have a role to play in our salvation. Number eight, baptism was the mark of becoming a disciple. You know, the command here is to make disciples. We talked about that already. We've established the fact that that is the instruction to make disciples. So where did baptizing and teaching come in? Well, the words for baptizing there in verse 19 and teaching in verse 20 are what you might call instrumental participles. Instrumental participles. It works like this. These words are here to tell us how something should happen. So, making disciples is what we are to do. Teaching and baptizing is how we do it. Make sense? Making disciples is what we're instructed to do, and we do that through baptizing and teaching. Now, baptizing, as taught in Scripture, is really a public identification that I am now a follower of Jesus Christ. I commit my life to following Jesus. It's a declaration of faith, commitment to follow Christ, to be his disciple. The Apostle Paul explains it beautifully.
don't have time to get deep into baptism now, but he explains how when a person is lowered into the water, they are identifying with the death and burial of Jesus Christ. I believe that Jesus Christ died and was buried for you. And when they're raised up out of the water, Paul says, that identifies with Christ being raised from the dead, resurrection, and how we are being raised to live a new life in Christ now as his follower. So it's a beautiful picture of salvation. And when a person is baptized, and so a person who becomes a follower of Jesus Christ then, who is a disciple, is baptized. Now let's move on to number 9, because it's not just about conversion. Our part in the Great Commission doesn't just mean get people saved. You know, just lead them to the altar, they get saved, and now we're done. They're on their own. Making disciples is a lifelong commitment. So making disciples isn't simply, you know, just present the gospel of Christ to somebody. They pray a prayer to receive Christ, and then you're on to the next person. It really requires a great deal of patience and grace. You see, baptizing can be a one-time event, but teaching that Jesus is talking about takes a lifetime. Making the disciple takes a lifetime. It's really, it's pouring your heart and your life into another person so you help them understand what it means to become a follower. And you're teaching them God's word. You're encouraging them to remain faithful and true to the Lord. You're helping them by praying when they have difficulties that arise. I mean, you're pouring your life into that person, discipling them, so that they too can go on and disciple someone else, who will disciple someone else, who will disciple someone else, who will disciple someone else. It's not like, well, okay, I'm saved, I got mine, I'm here, I'm good, I'm ready to go to heaven. Too many Christians do that. See, the whole role is for you to be pouring your life into somebody else to make another person a disciple of Christ, so that they can pour their life into somebody else and make someone else a disciple. So on and so on. So it's not just simply, again, I'm saved, I'm just waiting for God to come take me. You know, your life continues on this earth until he decides that time. And as long as he continues you here, you're making disciples. That's the role that we have in Christ. And this is number 10, the most important thing. We do not do it alone. We do not do it alone. Look at verse 20. Matthew 28, 20, Jesus said, "Surely I am with you," or y'all, "always, to the very end of the age. I will never, ever leave you. I will always be there. You can count on it." Jesus assures his disciples that he'll always be with them. Now, this is important when it comes to making disciples. Because if I was to do it on my own, I'd be very timid, hesitant. Don't know what to say. Don't know the right time to share the gospel. I'm afraid what other people might think of me. I could go on and on and on and on and on. I'm sure you could too. But knowing that Jesus is with me, that I am empowered by the Holy Spirit to share the good news of Jesus, makes all the difference in the world. Then if they criticize me, they're not criticizing me, they're criticizing Christ. He is the one who will give me the words to say. The right time to say it. The right people that cross my path that he wants me to share the good news of Jesus with. See, it's a good thing we are not alone, because if it was up to me, I'd blow it. But we have the assurance from Jesus himself that he will be with you all to the very end of the age. The power of Christ helping you to share Jesus with others. It's amazing. Now, I ask the question, how are we doing in sharing or completing the Great Commission? How are we doing completing the Great Commission? Well, I have a short video I'd like to show you that kind of gives an answer to that. Watch.
What are you going to do to change that?
Just some facts, you know, some figures that show you the great need in the world. It starts right here, Casa Grande, because there are plenty of people here who need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. But there are also many people around the world who have no access to the gospel. Now, the good news is the Alliance, the Christian Mission Alliance, the group that this church is a part of, sends more than 80% of their international workers to those unreached people groups where 2% or less have access to the gospel. We're probably the only organization that does that. We are committed to going to places where the gospel has not been yet heard. Many of them are very dangerous places. Many places we can't even talk about because they're creative access countries where we're not allowed to share because workers are not allowed to go in as Christians or missionaries. So we have great needs around the world, and you can be involved in that. And I just want to share with you briefly four ways in which you can help complete the Great Commission. These are four ways that were presented by the Alliance a few years ago. But I love the way they are very succinct and very direct. And you should be involved in at least one, if not up to three of these ways to help complete the Great Commission. Four ways. Pray, give, go, send. Pray, give, go, send. First one is pray. Everyone who is a follower of Christ can pray. Pray that God would send out workers into the harvest field. Pray that God would protect our workers who are there. Pray that God would give them opportunities, raise up new workers. Pray that there be great success in the various ministries. There is wonderful opportunities for prayer. And I will share one of them with you, and that is you can go to the Alliance website, which is cmalliance.org, cmalliance.org. The upper right is a link that says pray. You click on that, and every week, on Monday and Tuesday, they will have a new list of prayer requests for our workers around the world. And you can just pray through that list. You'll see what God is doing in various countries around the world, and you can get involved by praying for them, praying for the different needs that are there. You can also find a missionary on the same website and just pray for a single missionary. Maybe there's somebody that you know that's gone to the field. There's an importance in prayer. We've talked about that already. But you can be involved in the Great Commission simply by praying on a regular basis for God's work around the world. Secondly, pray, give. Give is another important way of becoming involved in the Great Commission. You can do that by giving anything. I mean, it could be a small amount or a large amount. The size doesn't matter. It's the fact that you're investing your resources in God's work around the world. And there are ways to do that. There are a lot of organizations asking for it. But again, I'll just direct you to the Alliance website, cmalliance.org. Up the right, click on the Give link, and you can give to the Great Commission Fund. The Great Commission Fund, or GCF, is the fund that the Alliance uses to support more than 700 international workers around the world. And you can be sure that your money is going there. So it's a great way of getting involved in missions. You can go there, click on the Give link, and give one time, or give on a regular monthly basis, however you choose. It's easy to give. You can give $1, $100 a month, whatever you want to do. It's there for you to do. But get invested in giving to the Great Commission. Okay? Thirdly, pray, give, go. Now, you may think, there's no chance for me to go. It's too late now. But it's not. We have many workers in our field who are retired. And most of them will go for anywhere from 2 weeks to 2 years. If you have an experience in the medical field or teaching or technology or anything else, even a dorm parent, you can go and help serve God in a mission field someplace on a short-term basis. And again, you can go to the cmalliance.org website, click on Serve at the top, and they'll give you opportunities to do that. There are lots of opportunities. So one of you just may say, you know, I feel like God has given me another year or so I can really become actively involved in missions and go to a field someplace around the world. It'd be great to do that. Or maybe you have a family member, a child or a grandchild, and you want to encourage them to go. That would be a wonderful thing to do. Fourthly, pray, give, go, send. Send is another way which all of us as believers can help the Great Commission, complete the Great Commission. As a body here, if somebody decides they want to go as a short-term missions, you gather around them, support them, send them out, give them the finances, the prayer, everything that they need. Again, if you have a child or a grandchild that wants to go to the mission field, encourage them, support them, help them to make it to the field, help them through those steps that need to get to the mission field. So these are the four ways in which every disciple of Christ can become involved in the Great Commission. Pray, give, go, and send. Okay? So I encourage you to participate. As we read our last telling of the core value number 5, having your sheet, it says, completing the Great Commission will require the mobilization of some disciples. No. It says every fully devoted disciple. It's going to require all of you together in community to complete the commission that God has given us to go and make disciples of all nations. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, I pray for the people of O.A.S.I.S. Community Church. You would lay it upon each person's heart how they can become involved in helping to complete the Great Commission that you've set before us. Whether it's through praying, giving, going, or sending, becoming actively involved in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, both here in this community as well as around the world. I pray that you would bless them. Your presence will be with them, so encourage them and give them the boldness and the courage to share the good news of Jesus with others. I pray this blessing upon them now in the name of Jesus, the one who came with a terrific mission to earth to seek and save the lost, and the one who now waits for us in heaven after that mission is completed. In the name of Jesus. Well, I encourage you to go on and read the other core values. Number 6, being empowered by the Holy Spirit, is tremendous. And also, number 7, faith-filled risk. You know, if you're going to achieve God's purpose here as a church, O.A.S.I.S. Community Church, it's going to require faith-filled risk. Now, I often say that's an oxymoron, because if your faith truly is in Jesus Christ, it's really no risk at all. But it's only a risk because we don't know exactly what the future holds. So stepping out and trusting God is the key for this group here. I want to share with you one last scripture, and this is to help send you on your way. So if you would please stand, and we will read God's word together as soon as I get to it. It's found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and these are some terrific words that the Apostle Paul leaves with the church in Thessalonica. And I pray this for you. Now may the God of peace make you holy in every way. And may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless until the Lord Jesus Christ comes again. God will make this happen. For he who calls you is faithful. God is faithful. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So go and live for Jesus.
Dave, Jan, thank you for joining us. Please greet them and say hi, goodbye. I don't know when we'll see you again, but we're ever so grateful for your presence to come and bring the word to us.
Amen. We're going to head for the door as fast as we can.
Yes, do. Take it out of here pretty fast.
No, we're not going to leave. We're just going to greet.